So just before we begin, a practical question. We are posting today the second undergraduate response paper. The official due date is April 5th, just because that's what's in the syllabus. There's a mistake in the production of the syllabus. We had intended to have an earlier due date. So we encourage you, if you write one of these papers, to present them by the first class after the spring recess. March 20th, I believe?
Yeah, 22, I think.
22. Just because on that day, we intend to announce the final paper for everyone, so that you'll have something like 5 weeks to write it. So it is in your interest not to let these tasks overlap. But between now and then, you have the spring recess to devote to these philosophical reflections.
Great, we can do this quickly, otherwise questions. So as Chris Roger mentioned, what we initially were thinking these both the papers for the undergraduates would be done earlier to give you more time for the final paper. There was a mistake, as you mentioned, with the production of the syllabus. And so of course we'll stick with the dates on the syllabus, absolutely, because we don't have very likely set your schedules accordingly. But as Professor Unger mentioned, we nonetheless, because we want everyone enough time to actually really think about the final project, we will hand out the questions for the final project on March 22nd, and that will give you more than a month to really think about them. For the undergraduates, what this means is, again, you are more than welcome to follow the actual dates given in the syllabus, but we want to strongly encourage you to do so earlier with the following argument. These first two papers are intended to be thought experiments to get you into the material, to get helpful feedback from Sasha in how you're framing arguments, how you're thinking about the material. But we really think of these more as training exercises for the final project, which we really want to be the focus of your thoughts and concerns. And this is why we're saying if you can fit it into your schedule, we do encourage you to hand in that second paper much earlier. It's very, very short. And if you can even get it in by the 22nd, that would mean you have the rest of that full time to be focusing on the final paper. So again, think of this not as oh no, I have to get this done earlier. Exactly, precisely. It's really intended to be a thought paper. In some cases, you may be doing a senior thesis that's due in late March, you have no choice. But in most cases, think of this as rather, it's a short paper, it's doable, and better to get it done. And if you do so, then again, you'll have the full time from March 22nd to April 27th to focus on the final project. Yeah, I'm sure many questions. So yes, please. Yes.
I was wondering if the due date for the final paper in the syllabus is still
there.
Yes. So that one's that we're happy to say one out of the three dates is correct. One out of three ain't bad. So yeah, that date is correct. It's the two dates for the small undergraduate papers that were moved back, and we're hoping to have it was going to be March 1st and March 22nd, and then that being March 8th and April 5th. But yes, one out of the three is correct. So the final due date is correct, that is April 22nd. Any other questions about the logistics of these? One of the things I will mention is you probably got the sense of the graduates who saw the first papers. You'll today be getting the second papers, again, just if you wanted to move through these more quickly. In terms of the final papers, it will again be handed out the questions on the 22nd. These will be, as you could probably gather by now, very open-ended questions. These are not research papers. These are asking you to think big, very much developing the work you've been doing on a weekly basis, and simply taking that to another level. So these will be very open-ended. The best way to prepare for this is to do what you're doing, which is every week, really wrestling with these ideas, and out of that will come the larger reflections. Great, yes, Sasha,
could
please.
I ask for one thing?
Of course.
It has occurred to me that the experiential dimension of something like meditative practices or the way we even get into the way we can talk about or describe what a self is, might require some spiritual journey. Would it be possible to give us a little space to account for it, to account maybe for the narrative of someone's encounter of how to approach the self? Would that be a possibility for a final paper other than?
Of course.
Yes,
absolutely.
Okay.
Of course, yes. But, you know, the spirit of the final written exercise is to provoke your engagement with the argument.
Yes.
Without imposing a grid on what is an admissible form of engagement.
Yes, yes.
So it's very open-ended.
Mm-hmm.
References to ideas and texts not considered in the course, and references to personal experience, to the testimony of experience, are all appropriate. If we did not want to be surprised by the form as well as the content of the responses, we would not design the But this has a practical consequence for you, which is, given the spirit of this exercise, it is not acceptable for you to come to one of us and ask, is this the right way of responding to the question? So that kind of conformity or search for a formula is not allowed. And in that sense, as you so would have said, you were forced to be free.
Please, yes.
Just wondering about the way it's going to be graded. Are the students in the law school going to be graded according to the scale of the law school and the students on the undergrads?
There's no grading occurred, and everyone is graded in the same way.
Everyone fails.
Good papers get good grades and bad papers.
Very controversial approach, but nonetheless.
Long experience has demonstrated that graduate training in any discipline, including philosophy, is an uncertain advantage. Benefits as well as detriments. No one is advantaged simply by virtue of having progressed more in formal schooling. So there's no reason to establish such a thing.
Very good. Indeed, just to underline that last point, I know several of you have been concerned about this, but I have no background in philosophy. How can I do this? As Professor Unger said, that is of no concern whatsoever. We do not expect any background. Feel free to build on whatever you're building on. And as Professor Unger said, the goal is to be engaged with the larger ideas. This is not, needless to say, an exam that is testing the degree to which you have mastered the material of the course. We are hoping to provoke you and inspire you to think big. And please come to that final project with that spirit. Great. So, let us now turn to the next major section of the course. To introduce it, let me begin with a very brief recapitulation of where we've come to up until this point, because now we're going to hit a brick, and we're going to have several thinkers who will be reacting strongly against the ideas that we've been looking at so far. So, in our first set of discussions, we were looking at those attempts to break out of what was seen as the dangers of the human condition in a particular way. If the dangers are seen to be ones in which we, as humans, are constrained by the world around us, we're born into a set of social conventions that will define us, a set of social practices that will determine who we are, the goal of that first set of readings is to help us as individuals break those constraints. And those attempts we were looking at were focused on autonomy. So, if each individual can become autonomous, breaking from the social conventions and practices that enchain him, that will allow for the possibility of freedom. We then turn to a second set of materials that is dealing with a similar set of problems, but with a slightly different solution, where the focus was not on radical autonomy of the individual, but rather love, radical love. Radical love that was aimed at the claim that if all human beings could truly achieve this form of radical love, the claim being it could only be achieved by an experience of the infinite that would be outside of the finite conventions and practices that otherwise would define us. That would open up the possibility as well for radical transformation. If in the former instance, the claims of autonomy were aimed at the individual breaking free of the bonds, the second alternative was aimed at a radical transformation of society. The argument being that that experience of a radical love would then be what could channel the experiments in radical social transformation that would later lead to the various movements like communism, capitalism, all the different isms that would play out over the course of the 19th and 20th centuries, fascism, I'm the horrible ones too, but all of these were attempts to create a new humanity. And the argument was, this in part is coming out of the claim of radical love. Now, we are switching gears. We are now switching gears to another mode of philosophy that will argue very strongly against all that we have been reading. It will argue that both of these are based implicitly on a claim of the will. In the first instance, what is really underlying claims of autonomy, according to this philosophies, the philosophy that we'll be turning to now, is in fact the radical self-assertion of the individual will. And in the second instance, what really underlies radical love is a radical assertion of the human will as against the rest of the world. And these philosophies argue that any such philosophy based upon support of the will as against the rest of the world is going to be inherently doomed and quite possibly very dangerous. Because the will is often, in fact, according to the philosophies that we'll be turning to, based in a series of things other than what these movements claim to be based upon. They are often based upon our desires, our instincts, our desires for ourselves, for things around us, attachments to things around us, desires for stability, desires for unity, desires for consistency, and our will, and the assertion of our will, is often, in fact, simply playing out these desires. And therefore, our radical claims of autonomy that sound wonderful because we are claiming autonomy from the world around us would, on the contrary, be, in fact, perhaps, at worst, simply the assertion of our worst desires for ourselves as against those around us and as against the world around us. And even our great social movements could be, despite our best intents, presumably, simply, again, playing out our worst desires. If this is the case, the argument will continue. The world that we are experiencing, including ourselves, are all products of this will. All of us. What we think of as the self is simply a product of this will. What we think of as these conventions and practices around us are simply the accumulation of the playing out of these various wills over a course of human history, into the history into which we are born. And if all of this is true, the last thing we would want to be doing is reasserting the will, because that will simply lead to the same problems all over again. The goal is to accept this fact, and in variations that we'll be looking at, reject the will. Reject philosophies of the will, at some level transcend the will, and transcend the world that has been created by the will. If we could do so, we would transcend the inevitable suffering that we are creating for ourselves by the worlds that we have created through simply the playing out of our will. And through that transcendence, we would achieve something higher. Now, I mentioned a few variations, just as an example. One that we'll be looking at next week will be one branch of Buddhism, which will put this in very strong terms. Your goal is to overcome the will, to therefore overcome the entire world that has been created by the will. And once you overcome that, once you transcend that, you will, in a very strong sense, not only achieve, by definition, personal transcendence, but much more importantly, you will transcend the self, because the self is nothing but a product of this will. And ultimately, the world will be changed, because the world itself is a product of the will, the world as we experience. That, as we will see next week, will be in certain branches of Buddhism, a radical formulation. Today, we turn to, this may seem somewhat odd to say when you're reading the figure that we are reading, it's a somewhat less radical set of claims, but perhaps, not to put words into your mouth, more maddening. But we want to begin with it because it shows the beginnings of attempts to think through a critique of the will and where it can take you. And then next week, we will look at a much more radical formulation, which would take us to even stronger places. But with that as a general introduction, both as to what we've been doing so far, and to this new set of philosophies that we'll be dealing with now, rejections of the will and attempts to transcend the will, let me now turn to our specific meaning of the day, Schopenhauer. And to begin this, let me actually begin it in a way that one of my great old professors, William Pearl, one of the great philosophers, students of history philosophy in the 19th and 20th centuries, would always begin his seminar on Schopenhauer. He would pick up a picture of Schopenhauer, and I were just discussing this before class, hold it up to the class, pause a second, if you've seen pictures, it's a very dour old man, and he'd say, "This is not a happy man." And then he'll begin the seminar. So Schopenhauer is not a happy man. Schopenhauer was very influenced by Buddhism, but he's taking a variation of Buddhism. The reason we've intentionally put these off, so we're reading Schopenhauer first and then Buddhism, is because he's really not a Buddhist thinker. He's really a thinker coming out of the continental tradition who has been influenced by Buddhism, but his real goal is a critique of the notion of will as it had become so dominant in late 18th and early 19th century European thought, very much including much of the material that we've been looking at. So let me give it, as always, a very, very brief introduction to the readings, simply to allow a basic understanding of some of the background, and then, as always, we'll focus on the larger discussion. So, a very quick background. The variations of the philosophy that I've been just mentioning, the way that Schopenhauer will come down on it, will be the following set of arguments. First of all, a quick discussion of some of this terminology, which will give you a sense of what he's doing here with the uses of words like the will. He is strongly critiquing a figure that we mentioned a couple of weeks ago, Immanuel Kant, who created a radical revolution in European thinking when he, Kant, argued that the world of our experience is in fact a product of human consciousness. That there is something out there, the thing in itself, the noumenon. We have no way of experiencing it. The world that we experience is a world that has causality, that exists in space and time, that has natural laws. That is a world that human consciousness has created. Things impact us, but we organize them into a coherent world. To which Schopenhauer would say, yes, but there are some problems in this. First, the argument assumes there is something out there outside of our consciousness, the noumenon, the thing in itself. And moreover, Kant is trying to argue that if we so organize the world properly, we will develop a properly rational understanding, both, not the world itself, but a rational creation within which we humans can rationally operate. And therefore, part of the goal of philosophy is therefore to, in a sense, do this properly organize the world. To which Schopenhauer will argue, wrong on both counts. The world of our experience certainly is a creation of consciousness, but underlying our consciousness is simply will. It's not rational, it is simply the will. And the will comes out of our base instincts and desires. And moreover, that world, the real world, the thing in itself, that Kant was talking about,
is the same thing.
That's what the world is. And the world, therefore, of our experience is indeed based on our will, but our will is part of this larger will. And in a very strong sense, he's going to try to argue, the world is simply the will. That's what the world is. But we humans, foolishly failing to recognize this, fall into the dangers, the traps that are created by trying to live in a world that we think is not so organized. And we play out our will, but when we play out our will, we are foolishly creating projects that are doomed to fail. So we play out this will, which oftentimes, in terms of human life, can take the form of simple instincts or desire, power, strength, accomplishment, all of which are ultimately doomed, and all of which we mistakenly understand as something else, something like, for example, describing the autonomy, the development of self-assertion, all of the things we were discussing in the first part of the course. With that, it is not, and we are doomed to a life of suffering. So, deal with this. What we do is we need to transcend these attempts to play out our will. We need to transcend these attempts to foolishly believe that our projects of self-assertion and autonomy are those, and rather accept that suffering is an inherent part of the world, and we therefore must renounce all such attempts to do everything that we were discussing in the first part of the course. This is simply the playing out of will, and the will is what should be rejected as a project. Now, I mentioned before, this is not the most radical formulation, which might strike you as rather surprising. Actually, it really isn't, because we will see next week an even more radical formulation, which will involve a more radical rejection of the world and a more radical rejection of even the human self within the world. Intriguingly, however, Schopenhauer, in a sense, ironically, considering the nature of the writings, as you've already gotten a sense for, he pulls back a little bit from the precipice. And so when you ask the question, which I think is a reasonable question to ask of Schopenhauer, suppose we did this, and what would be the result? Really does not give us a clear answer. Would we, for example, create a different world if we could renounce the will that underlies it? He seems to, by his own philosophy, to take that out of the realm of possibility, because the world really is will. So it seems the key for him is we must accept this fact and live accordingly. And yet he seems to reduce the door to which is to takes out the possibility that we, by renouncing the will, and renouncing the self that was created through the will, and renouncing the world that was then created through these foolish self-assertions based upon the will, that world would be radically altered. It's very unclear if he even allows for that as a possibility. In a sense, he simply seems to want to stop at a renunciation of our projects as human beings. So, we've begun with Schopenhauer in part for that reason. He is a brilliant thinker, but...
Oops. No, it's mine. Here it is.
One of us has a Siri talking to us. Yeah.
Yeah.
Even Siri is perturbed by Schopenhauer.
It's the will.
Indeed. Mm-hmm. So we are beginning this period of our discussions with Schopenhauer because it's, on the one hand, it pulls off the brilliant articulation of his position, very much pointed out actively so in opposition to some of the great texts that we've been reading, and yet part of the sort of chilling power, but I also, to be honest, maddening part of Schopenhauer is that he does stop there. He stops at the renunciation. It's how would we create a different world? You don't. The world is the will. And you simply stop. And human projects stop. So it's intriguing, I think, for us to think through the implications of this philosophy, and then that will also be a nice bridge toward next week, where we then will get a series of thinkers who will want to then think through what would be the implications if this world, this creation will, but the day before should conceivably not be. So, with that, as usual, a very, very brief introduction to the readings for today, let us either open things up immediately
Yes, absolutely.
So let us open things up, yes.
So would you say that Schopenhauer, I've heard Schopenhauer being referred to as an enlightened pessimist. Would you say he's just a pessimist, not an enlightened pessimist?
Well, I like the word enlightened pessimist. He's definitely a pessimist, but he would certainly claim it's an enlightened pessimism in the specific sense that for him, the pessimism only comes through enlightenment. In other words, enlightenment not in the Kantian sense, that we must recognize that we humans are the creators of the world and we must therefore create it properly, but rather for Schopenhauer, we humans must realize that we are simply part and parcel of the will and we must renounce that project. For him, it is in a sense an enlightenment project, but it's the precise opposite of the enlightenment project under a figure like Kant. You're not enhancing human powers to create the world well, you're renouncing the ability to do so. In that sense, in that specific odd definition of the term, and enlightened pessimism. Yes, please.
I just have a question about your intention. So
yes.
Are we trying to do what Rousseau does in what we read of him with Emile and Sophie, continuing from autonomy forward, the implications of autonomy, but are we trying to do so with Schopenhauer?
I know what you're getting at, and what I would say is, hopefully the reason we get this odds or juxtaposition text works, hopefully the reason it's working is because it's allowing us to think through the implications of these positions. So we begin with notions of autonomy because those are ones that we tend to immediately say, of course, into the autonomous people around us. And our goal was to give you some of the most powerful articulations of that position to say, if we want to assert claims of autonomy, note the dangers too. And note the dangers in the sense that if we therefore want to assert visions of autonomy, we really need to rethink the way we're doing it, because the way it has been done has philosophical problems, and as we've seen, has played out historically in potentially dangerous ways over the past 2 centuries. The same thing with visions of radical love. So the hope there was to both give you the excitement of those claims that created the world that we've been living in the past 2 centuries, and yet even those early formulations have the hints of the dangers that would play out as well, that we have gotten to know sadly all as well in the past 2 centuries. And hopefully the same here too. So if then we say, well, then let's reject the claims of autonomy, and let's reject philosophy's autonomy. So then let's look at those attempts, but again, to look at them seriously, meaning look at their power, but also the potential pitfalls, meaning that if we want to assert a negation of the will as a philosophy, are we comfortable with the way it's been done so far, and how should it be rethought and done differently if we want to go down that path? And so, getting back to your question, hope to do so is helpful for the autonomy question because it gave us a vision where, depending on how one even reads Rousseau, the vision that I think many of us would not be comfortable with, and perhaps, depending on how the reader Rousseau himself was realizing he wasn't terribly comfortable with toward the end of his life, and it then raises for us questions that we need to solve about how we would build a good philosophy of autonomy, a more powerful, productive philosophy of autonomy. And I would say it's very much the same thing here, the philosophies of rejection of the will.
I would just add to that. There's a fundamental metaphysical difference, a difference in the picture of ultimate reality. So in Schopenhauer's philosophy, the distinctions among phenomena and among selves, therefore autonomy, selfhood, are illusory. They're a delusive manifestation of reality. Reality ultimately is unitary and timeless. So the metaphysical picture that's developed in this philosophy is a picture that denies the factual premise on which the ideal of autonomy rests. That's the fundamental distinction. And our suffering, according to this philosophy, is provoked or aggravated by our surrender to illusion. So we find ourselves in the coils of a dying organism surrounded by a reality in which we seem to be different from everything else, and everything is what it is. And this hallucination generates our suffering or reinforces it. So here we have a characteristic example of a conception of philosophy to which I referred at the beginning of our course, a super science in the service of self-help. So the super science is the view of the nature of ultimate reality, which is hidden from us by our superficial experience. And the metaphysical antidote to this false view of reality is in the service of self-help. The self-help is so that we can overcome our tribulations, all of the suffering that we experience by virtue of mistaking these distinctions, including our independent selfhood, as something real. And the idea is, if only we could release ourselves through a series of disciplines from this idea, we could quiet our suffering. That's the self-help component. And in Schopenhauer's philosophy, there are two main disciplines by which we can achieve this effect. One discipline is sacrificial benevolent action. We recognize our unity with everything else. We identify with the holy. The holy is the one. And in this way, we overcome our suffering. And the other discipline is art. Because art, in Schopenhauer's philosophy, art and especially music, is a experience of reality or a view of reality which is will-less. It is disinterested. It's a way of seeing the world not encased in our sectarian interests as embodied organisms. And by these disciplines, against the background of this metaphysical picture, we cease to suffer. And that's happiness. Happiness is the absence of suffering, achieved through release from the will and communion with the ultimate unified reality.
And here it may actually even be helpful for to make a quick foreshadowing of next week to get to hear this, just a slight foretaste of the more radical version of this, because it might even help the discussion. So this slightly, the stronger and more radical version we'll be looking at next week makes these arguments, but takes it to the next level. So the argument will be that the world of our experience, ourselves, the world around us, our projects, are purely illusory. They are purely a product of our will. Our will is simply based in our base desires, despite our foolish attempts to think they are more than that. And therefore, the goal is to transcend all of this. And through a set of practices in which you are disciplining yourself to break out of the will that's being imposed upon the world, if you can transcend this, you ultimately transcend the self, because the self is nothing but a creation of the will. Nothing. You transcend the world around us, because the world around us is equally an illusory creation of the of other wills and our experience of it. And your goal is therefore to transcend the entire world of illusion, which is the world of individual selves in a world all of which which is illusory, a creation of our will. Now, the more radical version of this that you will see next week is to say, this is really possible. You really can so transcend, and if one so transcends, you completely break out of the self and the world within which the self exists, and by definition, by doing so, this entire world that's been created by the will would be radically altered, and in some variations, completely altered, because it has simply been a creation, an illusory creation, of the will. And again, as Professor Unger said, Schopenhauer's pulling back a little bit. He's not going to that next level. And so really, for Schopenhauer, the projects stop at as Professor Unger said, the self-help projects. I mean, the projects to make ourselves feel better by doing activities that train ourselves not to be asserting ourselves through the will, and by doing so, we ease our suffering. Whereas the more radical formulation next week will be to say, you're ending your suffering in a much more radical sense than that. You're not simply calming yourself down and taking life a little bit easier to end the suffering. You're actually trying to transcend the self and the entire world around us. Tons of hands, not surprisingly. I'm not quite sure the orders are. There's plenty of time. So yes, please.
So I'm just trying to understand how Schopenhauer's view doesn't lead to a self-deification of some sort.
Yeah.
How it doesn't lead to?
A self-deification of some sort. Yes.
The puzzling word there is self.
Exactly.
So, because in this philosophy there's the denial of the self. So how can the self be deified if it doesn't exist? There is a deification, but the self that can be deified is this ultimate unitary reality, which we are the epiphenomenal expressions. So I'm not sure that the term self-deification captures the intention of that idea. We become wholly deified, as you say, to the extent that we cease to be what we mistake ourselves to be, which are these individual selves, and we become something else. So it's another idea, and it's an idea which is in fundamental contrast to one of the key assumptions of the tradition that we have studied in the previous classes under the label of infinity. Because in that tradition, the distinctions among selves are for real, and they go all the way down. And historical time in which these selves act or succeed or fail is decisive. So in this view, not only are the distinctions among selves false, but history is a screen of illusion. It's a nightmare. It has no significance other than the significance of deflecting us from what is ultimately the case. So this is as about a fundamental distinction as we could ever find in the history of philosophy. And I do want later in my remarks then to once again press the question of what I call this epistemic gap. So we have these options. How do we choose among them? And it seems that the grounds for choosing among them are never adequate to the weight of the decision.
Yeah, just to underline that, I mean, all really the philosophies we've been discussing before, the ones based upon autonomy and the ones based upon radical love, were all based upon claims, albeit in different ways, of radical self-assertion. In the former, of course, radical self-assertion of the individual. In the second phase, radical self-assertion could move toward radical self-assertion, radical assertion of the human. But in each case, you're trying to divinize either the individual or divinize humanity in general. And indeed, Here, it's a complete break. The argument is any such attempt claiming self-assertion from either point of view is false because the goal is to overcome the self, break the self.
Right, please, yes.
So I'm just thinking about this in the context of the name of this course, I guess, The Cant of Life.
Yeah.
And unlike, say, Buddhism or Stoicism, which admit that life is mainly suffering but promise some sort of escape, some sort of reward,
yes,
this doesn't. And then, you know, sort of the two ways he identifies of maybe transcending the self for a little bit of time, as you mentioned, are sort of beneficial self-sacrifice or art. And from what I know of his biography, he was neither Mozart nor Mother Teresa. I'm kind of wondering what got this guy out of bed in the morning. You know, like, what can we take from this? What can we learn from this? How can we use this to think about our own conduct in life, as opposed to just sort of curling up in a ball and waiting for it all to end?
Well, he did recommend these two forms of salvation. Sacrificial action, universal altruism, and which is a detached benevolence. Again, in radical opposition to the idea that love is higher than benevolence. And second, a disinterested view of the world, which he saw as being mainly available in art. So the question of whether he was able to live his own philosophy is a different kind of question. Who knows? Who can live his own philosophy? Right? That would get us into another question. Huh? I do want to say, in relation to the issue of the epistemic gap, these radical options for which we never have adequate grounds, that there's the following contradiction in Schopenhauer's views. I cited in an earlier class a statement of his in the preface to a second edition of The World as Will and Representation. He says, my philosophy is the definitive solution to the enigma of existence. This is a clear statement of the ambition of a philosophical superscience. On the other hand, in one of his essays in Parerga and Paralipomena, he says, a person's philosophy is an expression of his temperament. These two statements seem to be in absolute contradiction with each other, unless one makes the arbitrary assumption that there happens to be a relation between one of these temperaments and the objective nature of reality. So it's puzzling. We have these views of the world. We can never defend them conclusively against their opponents, although we can give reasons for them that are more or less persuasive. And in the end, we must decide. We must commit our existence in one direction or another in the dark or in the relative light. So this is a theme that shadows us in all of our conversations here. And this is a very clear expression of it. But that's not an objection to Schopenhauer. That's a problem for all of us in all of these discussions.
Sasha, did you want to jump in?
I'll be the last one.
Oh, okay, absolutely. Please, yes.
Well, in response to what you were saying, I don't know if this is correct, but I sort of saw the one glimmer of hope here is Schopenhauer's understanding of intellect.
Yes.
And this idea of that even the intellect is bounded by, sort of is within the realm of will. But there's a superfluity of intellect that sort of has the potential to spill over and transcend will.
Yes.
And that's what he calls genius.
Right.
So in that sense, I guess that's the one salvation that one could go for. Mm-hmm. But in honesty, I'm still not convinced of that, because it does still seem sort of elitist, because not everybody has the raw ability to, for genius, like not every, not all minds, I don't know. But so in that sense, it just seems like he has this preference for those who have the potential to become philosophers. And they're the only people who can ultimately be happy.
So I would like to make a comment on the question of genius, because it's interesting in relation to this issue of the epistemic gap. So in the world and will and world as will and representation, Schopenhauer makes the following observation about talent and genius, the difference between a talented person and a genius. He says, the talented person is a marksman who hits a target that others cannot hit. The genius is a marksman who hits a target that others cannot see. So this is a fundamental observation and very interesting, because it is the idea that genius is not about smartness. It's not a form of facility. It's about vision. And vision, in principle, can be widely diffused within humanity. And we can even ask ourselves, what are the social and biographical conditions that allow for vision? So genius is not a kind of super smartness. It has nothing to do with smartness, according to this view that I think is correct. And this is very interesting for us in the situation around us, because we are surrounded by people who think that because they are very smart, they're entitled to be geniuses. And the truth is that there's no relation between facility and genius. Genius is about something else. It's about vision. And it is a prerogative of philosophy only in the sense that philosophy, and at its most ambitious, claims to be an exercise of vision. But vision could take other forms. And then we come back to the issue of the contest of visions, because we can see different things. And how do we then adjudicate among these visions? So this is very interesting. It's not like a genius is about a high IQ. It's not about that. It is in this philosophy. It has a redemptive significance, but it has a character which is fundamentally different from the character of facility, of acuity. It's about seeing things.
Could you maybe flesh out the idea of vision a little bit?
So it's the idea that if only we could. In Schopenhauer vision, so I'm not my idea of vision, Schopenhauer's idea of vision, if we could distance ourselves from the influence of our bodies and our place in history and in society and become more detached, we could extend our vision. We could see things as they are, as it were, from the perspective of the stars, rather than from our perspective as dying organisms. So that's what vision is. Vision in this idea is intimately related to detachment. And it's the ability not to be blinkered by our interests, our struggles, the struggles of the will, and especially the struggle, which I want to speak to later, with respect to our fundamental experience of insatiability. So this is something that Michael did not mention, but which is central to an understanding of this philosophy, as well as of its the form that we'll discuss next week. In Schopenhauer's picture of our experience, a central problem is that we are on the treadmill of desire, And it is our nature to want the unlimited. The world is not enough. But all we have around us are the limited. And so we demand the unlimited from the limited. That's our problem. And therefore we suffer. We're condemned to suffering. And so there's a practical issue of how we can release ourselves from this suffering and cease to demand the unlimited from the limited. That's the practical concern of the philosophy. And the vision is related in both directions to this task of mastering our insatiability. If we could see better, this is what, remember, Ken says to Lear, see better. If we could see better, we would be less insatiable. And to the extent that we are less insatiable, we can see better. So it goes in both directions. There's an intimate affinity between our struggle with our insatiability and our ability to see in this philosophy. This is a very profound idea. Now I'm saying this. I can't think of a philosophy that is more opposed to my own view of the world than this one. But I recognize the depth of this insight into the human condition.
Yes, so that's a very strong predisposition that Schopenhauer
claims. A concept which the 21st century psychology can define rather concretely and say that self is an illusion. Is this just what we have to accept? We have to suspend our disbelief and accept whatever he says and then play the game out in that direction? Or is there a more general truth that we might have been missing? Or I'm not sure I understand. To me, self is no illusion.
Well, here, let me again foreshadow a bit of next week, where this is argued in depth, and I think very powerfully. The argument would be, understand illusion not as the way we tend to use the term, which is that you wipe away this and you'll see the reality. The sense here of the Buddhist notion of illusion is, we create such a world. It's illusory in the sense that it's wrong, but we really do create it. So, getting back to the notion of the self, is there really a self? In Buddhism, the argument is no, but we, through our desires, create a self. And we create the self, we create social constructions based upon the self, we create worlds assuming selves, and the world around us, therefore, has in that sense been created, but it is illusory in the sense that it is really not as we perceive it. In fact, the selves do not exist. Everything truly is one, but it's illusory in that sense. Now, to show you how extreme this is, the argument is there even is reincarnation, but it's not that I have a self that is being reborn over the generations. It's rather that I have created this self, and that stuff keeps coming back. But again, it's illusory, therefore, as you can see immediately, not in the sense that it's pull away the curtain and you'll see reality. No, we've created this thing, the self, and the worlds around the self, but it's illusory because once you undergo the proper practices, then you can break from your desires. Once you break from your desires, this self that you think is so permanent and powerful, at least while we're living this life, is actually seen as what it is, which is non-existent, and equally true of the world. So in answer to the question, it is intended to be a radical refutation of the world of our experience. But again, illusion, therefore, as you can see, is being used in a very strong sense of the term.
In the Buddhist sense, the way I understand, they also disallow science. So So I'm okay with that because it's setting the groundwork, because they see science as dichotomous, and that there's a, that creates dualities, and they don't want that. So I'm okay, they deny duality, they deny science, and then you can go ahead. But I'm asking, am I to disavow science too in this discussion? Because otherwise I'm inclined to depend on it.
The answer is not necessarily, it depends how one understands scientists, or even the practice of science. So are you, for example, thinking of science as trying to understand the world as it really is? Are you trying to understand the world as we construct it? Either way, it can be a very productive enterprise, but you're acknowledging what the enterprise really is. We'll actually come back to a lot of this next week, and we're actually reading Buddhist texts. Yes. Yes, please.
So just again on that point, if under sort of the Buddhist methodology or way of thinking, we do acknowledge that this world, though an illusion, is a creation in some sort of objective sense, do they offer, or is there an argument offered for why we should transcend, like why we should prefer this real world to this thing that we've created?
Yes, so the argument, and here Schopenhauer is coming directly out of it, and directly influenced by it, the world that has been created through our desires is an inherent world of suffering. And so, to give you one of the examples that the Buddhists will give very strongly, so I desire a world in which I, through my self-assertion, can achieve great things. I can achieve fame, fortune, and I fall in love, I can be with someone, and that person will be loved forever while I'm alive. And I, in my desires, I'm hoping for my greatness within a stable world, within a stable set of relationships, and if, as long as I assert myself well, I will succeed and have these great relationships and great fame and fortune, etc. However, in fact, all of this, by doing so, I am simply creating these attachments to things that are in fact illusory, and all of this will fail. All of my projects of self-assertion are in the long run doomed to failure. All of my claims that I have been in a relationship with a stable person are false because I'm not stable, that person is not stable, and as long as I see it as such, we are doomed to suffering. And so, yes, we are consigning ourselves to a life of pure suffering because all of our projects are absolutely doomed because they're based upon false premises, based upon our desires within an illusory world.
So just further, so there. The answer to your question is that there are two stakes. There's the cognitive stake and the practical stake. The cognitive stake is to see the world as it is, and not as we would like it to be or imagine it to be as we perceive it, given our encasement in these dying organisms of ours. And in the world as it really is, everything turns into everything else. And the distinctions among things and among selves are transient and shallow. That's the cognitive stake. And the practical stake is that so long as we build our lives and our consciousness of the world on the basis of the false view of the world, we will be condemned to suffer. And we will have no antidote to this ceaseless insatiability. So the very core of this philosophical project is the connection established between the cognitive stake and the practical stake, the super science and the self-help.
You mentioned in Ring Up a couple of times saying that we have to decide between different choices. And stuff.
Could you speak more loudly?
Well,
how do you not choose? So the idea would be you live your life in one way or another, and the way in which, and whether or not you make an explicit philosophical commitment, the way in which you live your life demonstrates that you have one set of views or another. Now, or you could have confused views, which presumably is the normal situation. And but then you're pushed back and forth between. It's not as if you on this argument. It's not as if you could have an existence without presuppositions. You can have implicit presuppositions, but you can't have no presuppositions. Or you could have confused presuppositions. Is that not true?
I would disagree.
And how so?
By saying that, I just need to organize very quickly. Mm-hmm. I think these presuppositions come from presuppositions themselves. It's like a circular sort of thing, and it creates a distinction. Conceptualizations, pure and simple, and any form of conceptualization negates something. Conceptualization isn't creation. Conceptualization, for me, is negation, is saying, is abstraction. Saying something is like an ism or a presupposition or something like that is removing things from the world rather than adding things to the world. And therefore, by already creating a presupposition of presuppositions,
It seems to me what you're saying to my mind seems too complicated. So take just a simple divergence. So someone could decide this world isn't worth it and live as a hermit with minimal engagements and connections, lowering the energy level and the connection level. Or someone else could go out and struggle to develop families, reorganize the state, revolutionize society and culture. By the way in which they live, they reveal that they have different assumptions about what's for real and what matters. So that's what's at stake. We're going to live in one way or another. Whether we make our ideas explicit or not. And I don't really see how one could escape making these assumptions about what is for real and what matters. And that's what's at stake in this contrast among options.
I have a question about the Schopenhauer refers to the will as these primal desires.
Yeah.
And so I'm wondering where those primal desires came from.
Did you say?
Aristotle. But we'll get into this later.
I mean, does he believe in a theology that, like, what is the creation of these primal desires? Where did they come from?
You mean the this wanting more and more? Well, this is his empirical view of what we are, of what all beings are. They're struggling. So Schopenhauer, for example, makes early on in The World as Will and Representation the observation that at any given time in the world, countless numbers of animals are tearing one another apart alive, just to live a little longer. And he says that's the nature of reality, that they're encased in these organisms, they're struggling, they're wanting more. And we are like these animals, according to Schopenhauer, except for more, because they may have programmed or defined desires, and our desires are unlimited. We want the unlimited, we want everything. And from one another, we want everything. We want something that we cannot give one another, and so forth. That's his empirical picture of, and it's what happens in a world in which the unitary character of reality is obscured and suppressed, because reality then appears under the form of these different selves and different phenomena. Now, one of the philosophical puzzles of this whole tradition of thinking in Schopenhauer and Plotinus and Plato and any number of its radical or qualified forms is none of these philosophers has provided us with an account of why it is that the world should appear under a form that contradicts its true reality. Why is the world like this? So it's a question that's related to the familiar philosophical question of why does the world exist at all? But it's a more specific question. Why does the world exist under a form that is the negation of what it really is? Why? That it should wear this disguise, this mask that is the denial of its true reality. This question is not answered in these philosophies. Yes?
As a response to what you just said, I'm wondering if the problem is with the world that it disguises itself, or the problem is with the limitation that human beings have in seeing the world. So, and if these two are different questions, and is it just what you mentioned about the constraints that we feel as human beings, in our limited capacities?
Well, but none of these philosophers denies that the world appears under the aspect of difference, that there are different phenomena and cells. They deny that these are for real. They say they have a lower degree of reality or they have no reality, but the world manifests itself in a delusional form. It manifests itself as what it is not. Why? Why does the world hide itself? Yes. Yes.
The world is chaotic. The human has evolved and is here today because we have a brain which can find recognizable patterns of behavior and of systems and what have you, that we can go out and tame our limited environment so we can survive and eat and shelter ourselves and in a way protect ourselves from a chaos. We limit the chaos. We don't totally eliminate. But that is the nature of the human being. I wouldn't call that a delusion. It's our adaptive capability. It's what brought us.
Yes.
Okay, that's my answer.
But we're trying to explain from the perspective of these philosophies, which apparently neither you nor I share, right? So we're trying to explain from their standpoint. Not from our standpoint. Why is it that the world appears under a form that contradicts its true nature? That's the question that's being presented.
Yes, please.
I'm slightly different there. I just had a question reading Schopenhauer's section on the vanity of existence about, he talks about existence and error of the consequences. And I was just wondering like how that ties into how we view the world and like that perspective, and I'm trying to shed some more light on that.
But isn't it the same thing, the vanity of existence, the that this individual existence is not ultimately or truly real? What is the specific point that you're?
But talking about as an error, as a consequences, as an error, rather than the fact that
so it's a mistake. Yes.
Yeah,
yes. Yes. So it's not the way, according to this philosophy, it's not the way things really are.
Okay.
So I think it's useful here to remember a distinction in the world history of philosophy between two major traditions. One of which has been the predominant tradition in the history of Western philosophy, and the other of which has been the predominant tradition in the history of ancient Indian philosophy. So One tradition is that comes from the philosophy of being of the ancient Greeks, and it continues to be the major tradition in Western philosophy. So it says there is a permanent stock of natural kinds in the world, of ultimate constituents of reality, and of permanent regularities governing these constituents. So the distinction among the natural kinds is for real. And they're a kind of permanent stock. And the major tradition of fundamental physics in the modern West translates this philosophical idea into science. So it's the tradition of physics from Newtonian mechanics to quantum mechanics and relativity. There's a basic set of constituents of nature. It's described at the most fundamental level by the standard model of particle physics, and at a more superficial level by the periodic table in chemistry. And there are permanent regularities, which are the laws of nature, the constants of nature, and the symmetries of nature. The permanent stock and the permanent regularities are exempt from time. So time is real, but not completely real, because it doesn't include everything. There's an exception. There are two exceptions to time. The permanent stock of ultimate constituents of nature and the permanent regularities of nature. That's one tradition in philosophy and in science, the predominant tradition in the West. Now, there's a second tradition, which was predominant in ancient Indian philosophy. And it says, everything changes into everything else. Everything changes sooner or later. And all the distinctions among things and phenomena and selves are transient and shallow and illusory. The only thing that really exists is the one reality, which undergoes these transmutations. And reality is timeless. Now, the curious thing is that these two seemingly opposing traditions of thought, the two major traditions of philosophy in the history of the world, have in common the association of the criterion of reality with the criterion of eternity. So the shared view is that the more real something is, the less time-bound it is. So in the second tradition, it's the one, which is timeless. And in the first tradition, it's the basic constituents of nature and the regularities of nature, which are also outside of time. Now, you might think that there would be a third position. And the third position would be the position that everything that exists is transient and has an end, and everything changes into other things. Everything changes. And nothing is outside of time. So there is no permanent stock of natural kinds. We have this idea, for example, in biological evolution. There are no permanent species. And there are no permanent regularities, because the way things change also change. So the laws of nature, the constants of nature, and the symmetries of nature are themselves historical. They have a history. There is much in the discoveries of 20th century cosmology that might suggest the truth of this third view, and much in our own experience. The strange thing is that this third view, which on many grounds might seem to be the most persuasive view is the one that speaks with the weakest voice in the history of philosophy. So this third view, for the most part, has not been philosophized, even though it seems to be much closer to the truth than the other two views. The third view requires us to detach the criterion of reality from the criterion of eternity. Something does not cease to be real because it is transient, according to this third view. Everything that exists is transient and not less real by virtue of being transient. So this is the third position. And to the extent that my interventions here depend on a metaphysical background, it's this third picture which I take to be more real than the other two ones. Now, so Schopenhauer is like Spinoza, and in some respects also like Leibniz, are philosophers who, within the tradition of Western philosophy, represent that second tradition. And of course, in the tradition of Indian philosophy or Chinese philosophy, there are philosophers who represent the first position. But what, on the whole, we strangely lack in the world history of philosophy is the development of the third position. So this is very interesting. This is a very interesting feature of the history of philosophy. Yes?
Yes, may I ask a difficult question about the third position? I'm eager to see how would you reconcile the notion of self-identity, without which nothing that emerges in however complicated metaphysical or physical picture of the universe is possible at all. Because for anything to be and to endure as an intelligible thing for any amount of time, you must grant that we even in principle have this position.
I don't see why the recognition of the historical character of being would undermine self-identity. So let's give the example of how we think in natural history. I say natural history because I have in mind not simply the life sciences, but also the way we think about nature before life, as in geology. So there are three characteristics of our natural historical thinking that are in contradiction to the way we think in that first philosophical tradition about the permanent regularities, the permanent stock of things. First, the emphasis on path dependency. So everything depends on what happened before, and there many causal sequences, but the causal sequences are loosely related, so that there's an important element of accident in the evolution of the cosmos of nature. So, give you an example from evolutionary thinking. So, mammalian evolution proceeds through the placental line rather than the marsupial line. The placentals became dominant. Why? Maybe not because of some inherent advantage of theirs, but because it happens that the marsupials were caught in a relatively isolated landmass. And because of the movement of the landmasses due to plate tectonics, they were isolated in the Australian continent. And then the main line of mammalian evolution becomes the placentals. So they're causal sequences, but they're not meshed together into some rational grid. So that's the first characteristic. The second characteristic is the historical character of the natural kinds. So there are different kinds of rocks, there are different kinds of species. There's no permanent stock of them. They arose at a certain moment. The way in which each of them change, or the way in which they differ from one another, is different. So a metamorphic rock is not different from another metamorphic rock in the same way in which a sedimentary rock is different from another sedimentary rock. The third characteristic of our natural historical thinking is that we, in natural history, we think that the regularities co-evolved with the phenomena. So the regularities governing life developed together with life, and the rules of Mendelian genetic recombination did not precede the development of sexual organisms and so forth. It's just a metaphysical presupposition to imagine that they were somehow floating there in reality, waiting to come onto the scene of actuality. That's how we think in natural history. And there's nothing contradictory or incoherent about it. But we could think about that way cosmologically, with respect to the whole cosmos. It's just that this dominant tradition of physics, of foundational physics, comes from the Greek philosophy of being and appeals to this notion of trans-historical constituents of nature and permanent regularities of nature, which seems to be undermined by the discoveries of contemporary cosmology. So what I'm saying is that we have many reasons in our experience and in our scientific discoveries to question the hegemony of these two philosophical traditions that have prevailed in the history of thought. And this is a source of confusion and disorientation in our ideas about ourselves. So in addressing any of these philosophical projects, we can come from two directions. We can come from the direction of a reading of our experience, of what works, of what the testimony of our experience is, or we can come from an understanding of the background of reality and the extent to which one of these projects relies on a view of realities that is false. And that means that we have some hope of progressing in our understanding. So I want to be very careful about this. That is, on the one hand, in our arguments, I want to say that there is this epistemic gap, that we have to make these options and we never have conclusive reasons for making these options. But that doesn't mean that we can't progress in our clarity by these devices. We're in the darkness, but we can increase the area of light. And that's just a huge advantage that we have, because then the way in which we live our existence would be less a gamble in the dark. We would be able to shed some light on how we choose to live, although the light would always be insufficient. But we're extending the area of light. So I'm taking the position of the party of enlightenment, because you know that I'm a defender of the Western revolutionary orthodoxy, and this is one of its expressions. Yes.
Yes. So if I hear you correct, to the Aristotelian physics and metaphysics, you're saying first physics, then metaphysics, if any metaphysic at all.
No, I'm not against metaphysics or physics, or claiming that one has priority to the other. I'm saying that the picture of reality in this tradition that is the dominant tradition in Western philosophy may be false. And that it's not true that the only alternative to it is this idea expressed in Schopenhauer or in the dominant tendencies of ancient Indian philosophy, that there's only the timeless one and that everything else is shallow and superficial. We have another path. Strangely undeveloped in the history of philosophy. But that would be the view that we would most need to develop.
I agree with that because I think that fundamentally this is the inside of Plato, that the good, the just, the beautiful, whatever it is, it's an extra-systemic principle which shouldn't be access to us. And everything in the human life, including some of his views on how to live a best life, implies a certain radical asymmetry, which is the true sign of the divine.
Well, usually I agree with people who don't agree with me, but now it's the inverse. So you say you agree with me and I don't agree with you. because of this reference to Plato. But let me come in and make some remarks now about our discussion today in Schopenhauer, which in some respects complement, but in other respects contradict Michael Pewitt's presentation. So, and I'm going to be very summary in my statements. So let me begin with an idea that came up in an earlier conversation in the course before coming to Schopenhauer. And the idea is the contrast between two conceptions of happiness. Remember, this came up in one of the interventions in an earlier class. Two conceptions of happiness. So one conception of happiness is happiness is the absence of suffering, therefore of contradiction, of insufficiency. It's a quieting. The temperature comes down. It's one conception of happiness. The other conception of happiness is surfeit of life, of activity, its fullness. It's an expansion of being and of action. And that second conception of happiness must include contradiction, tension, which is rejected in the first conception of happiness as being a source of pain. This is a fundamental contrast in our ideas about what we want. And these different philosophical notions that I just described in some way bear on this, though how exactly they bear on the choice between these two conceptions of happiness is not wholly clear. Now I come to the project that Schopenhauer exemplifies and develops. So let me describe this project as in relation to three components. So one component is to establish contact with reality as it is, unified and timeless. Communion with ultimate reality. Ultimate reality is eternal and not divided. So it is true that we must overcome the will, but the goal is not the overcoming of the will. The overcoming of the will is the path. The goal is to be in communion with reality, with the way things really are, in the hope that if we establish this connection, we will release ourselves from needless suffering. Now, then the second component is, how do we recognize that we are progressing to this end? By two characteristic attitudes or experiences, which are the manifestation of our communion with ultimate and timeless reality. One is, we progress in serenity, in self-possession. We cease to be tormented, or we become less tormented. And the second is by our benevolence to other people, but to the whole world. Because we see that the world is one, we're part of the one, we're all the same thing. Serenity and benevolence. These are the expressions of our triumphal progression from the coils of suffering and illusion. Then the third component is, therefore, the metaphysical picture, which I just described as the first tradition, as the second tradition. Everything turns into everything else. All the distinctions in the world are illusory. The only thing that's real is the timeless one. That's the metaphysical picture. And the metaphysical picture can be enlisted in the service of self-help to quiet our suffering. That's the project I've described in its three components. Now, then, what are the disciplines that allow us to implement this project in our own experience? In Schopenhauer's philosophy, there are these two main disciplines that I referred to earlier. The first discipline is sacrificial action. The expression of benevolence. We identify with the holy, the one. We act in a non-self-interested way. And in this way, reinforce our communion with reality and cease to operate as the dying organisms that we are. The second discipline that we have is to seek those forms of human activity that are peculiarly disinterested, that allow us to see the world from a disinterested perspective. And for Schopenhauer, the highest expression of this is art. So Schopenhauer, in his reflections about the stages of human life, says children, in their earliest infancy, see the world this way, in a disinterested form. Maybe because he had so little contact with children, but this is his comment. And then in art, we recapture this experience of infancy. Now, there's a third discipline, which doesn't play a role in Schopenhauer's philosophy, but does play a role in other versions, such as the Buddhist and Hindu versions, these theories, which are a series of techniques of consciousness by which we learn to focus on the reality around us or a part of us and to cast aside all of the peripheral. And it's as if we cast a spell on ourselves, which also quiets our suffering, kind of self-hypnosis that allows us to escape the constraints of our embodiment. These are the disciplines by which we implement the project. Now, I introduce a third element of descriptions of this set of ideas. I spoke about the project, the disciplines. Now, what are the motivations of this view. So it seems that there are two main motivations. A philosophical, metaphysical motivation is the first, which is a view of how things really are. That's the second tradition that I described. Starting from the observation that everything changes into everything else. But mistakenly, to my mind, inferring from this observation that therefore, because everything is transient, it's somehow less real. Once again, the association of reality with eternity. The second motivation, which is the much more powerful motivation, the prompt, as it were, for this philosophical project, is the struggle with our insatiability. In this view of human life, this is the central problem. That we're tormented because we want more and more. We want the unlimited, and all we have around us are the limited. And so it begins in a reflection on the character of human desire. Human desire is roaming and unlimited, and nothing is enough for us. And it has two features which aggravate this character. The first feature is that our human desire is mimetic. It's empty. We're not like the animals, as Schopenhauer says, who have these scripted desires, the other animals. We can desire anything and desire everything. And in particular, what we do desire is what the other people around us desire. So our desires are, as it were, the outcome of our being kidnapped by the people around us. And therefore, we are ambivalent to our own desires because they are us and they are not us. And our ambivalence to our own desires poisons our relations to the other people. Because we recognize in our own desires our kidnapping by the others, given this mimetic character of human desire. And the second feature of desire, which aggravates our insatiability, is its projected character. So we want the unlimited, but all we have is the limited. So we project our desire for the limited onto unworthy objects, which are all these limited things around us. And the clearest expression of this phenomenon is in the experience of addiction or obsession, in which some paltry thing or phenomenon becomes for us the object of unlimited desire, as if it were the divine, the absolute. And we're then in this treadmill in which we're on the hunt for the unlimited, demanding it from it, the unlimited. When we experience the limited, we become sated and bored because we recognize that it's not what we really wanted. And then the phenomenon of insatiability begins all over again. So then our life is this perpetual torment. That's the psychological or experiential prompt for this philosophical project. And so then the idea is let's marry the discovery of the true nature of reality with this practical effort, this practical campaign to free ourselves from the treadmill of insatiability. That's the effort. Now, then we can ask, does it have a chance of working? So we come to the next part of my remarks then. How would we criticize it? How would we question it? Seems to me we can question it from two basic directions. First of all, we can question the reality of its assumptions about the world, this second tradition, which denies the reality of the ephemeral. There's a great deal in our experience and in science suggesting that this view is false. What's real is what is ephemeral. But the second way in which we can question this project has to do with how it works in our experience or psychologically. Will it achieve the objectives that it announces? Can we, in fact, achieve serenity and self-possession by these disciplines that Schopenhauer recommends? So that's a question of experience. And the objection would be that we can't. We can't do this. Or we can do it only at a vast price. So we would contain our experience. We would lower the temperature. We would suppress the contradictions. And in the end, what would we have? We would have less being, less life, less fecundity, less activity. And there would be always something of us left over, which would express itself in boredom or anxiety. Unless we somehow succeeded in dying before we're dead. So in other words, to the extent that this project succeeds, according to this objection, it succeeds by dealing with the problem of death, of our mortality, by killing us beforehand, as if it were a foretaste of death. And that then is the experiential argument against it. Now, at the end, then I come back to what I said at the beginning. This argument that I'm making is an inconclusive argument because it's trading on that ambiguity with which I started between two conceptions of happiness. So I'm making an argument which enlists the second conception of happiness against the first. Happiness as fullness of life, of activity, of being, against the idea of happiness as privation of suffering, diminishment of tension and contradiction. And someone can say at the end, but I don't want this fullness of being at the cost of all this contradiction and tension. I want to get by with the minimum of suffering, and we can doubt that he can be for real when he says that, because we can say that's not what a human being is. A human being transcends. A human being is not fully contained within a particular limited range of experience. So that's where the argument stops, because it's a contrast of two conceptions of who we really are. But it's not just a contest of dogmas, because in the end there's the testimony of experience. If we apply these disciplines, will we become serene, or will we become just cranks? Will we have an experience of liberation, or will we, on the contrary, have an experience of enslavement under the appearance of serenity? So this is how I propose that we approach this project, in which, as you notice, my motivation is to do justice to the powers of reason, but not too much justice, so that there's this idea of we're extending the area of light, but we're still in the darkness. Yes.
I just have a question.
happiness, yes.
I don't see why you can't reconcile both of them by saying, like, why can't happiness be the removal of suffering by the expansion of being?
Well, but that seems to me to be a purely verbal reconciliation. If you're saying that, what you're really doing is you're preferring the second conception of happiness to the first. So you're saying that if you expand the scope and intensity of existence, tolerating a high level of contradiction and complication, all the suffering will be overtaken, and so it's not that there won't be all these things, but there'll be this great waterfall, this current, and you'll live life more fully, more intensely, until you die, until the moment you die. You'll die only once, as opposed to this idea of let's protect ourselves from death by a kind of pre-dying. This is the argument that I make from my standpoint against this view, the debate about experience. So I think this is It's interesting because there are these two components, right? There's, as I said, the component from above, which is the metaphysical conception. How do we look at the world in the debate among these three traditions, the two existing ones and the one which we should create? And then there's the component of our reading of experience. Now, again, in the particular historical circumstance that we're in, let's give names to this. So that these revolutionary political and personalist projects of democracy, liberalism, socialism on the political side, romanticism, popular romanticism on the personal side, are all taking the position of the second view of happiness. They're going out into the world, and they're being combated by contrary views in the world. There's a struggle. And within the societies in which these views, the second view of happiness, is the canonical view, the orthodox view, there are countercurrents. Because there's this subreptitious paganism in which the educated and disillusioned classes are privatizing the sublime. They are seeking relief in an inner world, so there are these hidden Schopenhauerians, right? So we who are engaged in the struggle for the revolutionary project face the overt enemies in the world, but then we also face the fifth column at home, of the hidden paganism, and so that's the correlation of forces as it exists in the world at the moment. Yes. Well, I'm not sure that there's a real distinction there, because what's meant by this phenomenon of insatiability, which after all is described and theorized in these traditions of Buddhism, Hinduism, is that we're on this treadmill. So we want more, then we get what we wanted, then we say, that's not what I really wanted. Then it becomes all over again, and the moment of satiation is the moment of boredom, right? And what is boredom? Boredom is the manifestation in emotion and experience of our being unresigned to the finite. So
It is not enough to occupy it. We take that. Against boredom, the gods themselves are helpless. So this is a basic experience of human beings. That's what makes it insatiable. That we don't want the limited. We want the unlimited. We want more, 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 and more. And then the issue is how we get off this, in this tradition, how we should get off this treadmill. Now, we would think in the view studied under the label of love and affinity, that there are two basic ways by which we can deal with insatiability, which are fundamentally different from the disciplines recommended by Schopenhauer and by the philosophers of Nietzsche. Love. And the direct and indirect forms of love. Love is the answer to insatiability. That's the first answer. And the second answer is a transformative vocation. Our struggle to change ourselves by changing the world. By orienting our existence to a project that is too large for us. And then we act in our finite circumstance as if we were not the playthings of our finite circumstance. We live in the present or the future as those who are not determined by the present circumstances of their lives. These are the two ways in which we would deal with the problem of insatiability. They're fundamentally different from the disciplines recommended by Schopenhauer and